Good morning and welcome to the first meeting in 2024 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee, and I'd like to wish members and all of those participating or watching a happy new year. And I remind members and witnesses to ensure that all their devices are on silent. And the first item of our agenda today is to decide whether to take item 3 in private. Are members agreed? And at this time I'd like to invite members who wish to declare an interest. Marie.
Thank you, Convener. Just to declare that up until 2022, I was a local councillor in West Dunbartonshire.
And Stephanie.
Thank you, Convener. Just declaring that until 2022, I was a local councillor in South Lanarkshire.
Thank you very much. Great. We now turn to agenda item 2, which is to take evidence on the Scottish Government's budget 2024-25, and that's from Martin Booth, who's the Executive Director of Finance at Glasgow City Council, Kirsty Flanagan, who's the Director of Finance at Argyll and Bute Council, Sarah Fortune, who's the Executive Director for Council Resources at East Lothian Council, and Jamie Robertson, who's the Chief Finance Officer at East Dunbartonshire Council. And I will start with an initial question. I'd be interested to get a sense of any assessment that you've made on how the Scottish budget 2024-25 will impact your local authorities. What is the estimated gap that you require, and what you are likely to receive from the Scottish Government in 2024-25? There's a few questions in this. Will you have the necessary funds to fill statutory duties? And if there are gaps, what approach will you take to fill them? So maybe I'll start with you, Martin.
Thank you. It's difficult to be very prescriptive at the moment on the settlement. We only got the settlement the day before Christmas. But the kind of headlines are that it's not a good settlement for local government. The headline figures of 5% real terms increases aren't really accurate, because that's taking into account significant elements of funding over the last couple of years, particularly for pay awards. So that's if you compared our budget at the end of the year to what our budget will be at the start of the year, we actually think there's a reduction. So the floor mechanism has been set at 0.5% below the average settlement, and the average settlement is -0.54. So the floor's been set at -1.04%. So again, that's showing that the average is a negative figure. The inflation that we all understand, that we're all facing individually, you know, and as households, is equally being felt by local government. Pay inflation, food inflation, construction cost inflation, I think we all understand the massive pressures that's placing. How we'll deal with that, I think it does put pressure on all the services we deliver, with the amount of directed spend within our budget, where at the moment we have to maintain teacher numbers, we have to maintain our contribution to our IGIBs. The areas where the budget pressure falls are a very limited part of our budgets. I think I've used the term before, it's bins and libraries are the areas that are kind of left. I think there is pressure on our statutory services. There's pressure particularly, I think, across the country, but certainly in Glasgow, on homelessness and the pressure that's creating, and the UK government's policy on fast-tracking asylum seekers is exacerbating that problem, probably particularly in the cities, but that will spread wider than the cities as well. We'll go through the normal process that we've gone through now for a number of years, where we have to make cuts year on year. That becomes more and more difficult every year. I think it's probably fair to say that what would have started out, you know, 15 or 20 years ago as efficiencies aren't efficiencies anymore, they are cuts. So it's a very challenging budget, I think, across the board. I don't think any of us are sitting expecting an easy time as part of our budget process that will take place over the next couple of months. And for some authorities, it's really, really difficult.
OK, thank you very much for painting that picture. Does anyone else want to come in on that Sarah.
I'm happy to come in. Obviously, from East Lothian's perspective, absolutely concur everything that Martin has indicated. This is a hugely difficult kind of time. Certainly for us in our authority, and probably one of the fastest growing authorities across Scotland, we've got huge population growth and significant challenges at both ends of the spectrum with both, you know, significant increase in number of children and also elderly population. This is hugely difficult kind of for us in terms of kind of the settlement at the moment. Absolutely concur kind of with what Martin has indicated. We are now facing probably the most significant funding gap than we have ever experienced coming through here. It is now looking at service cuts. There are... in terms of your question whether or not there is enough funds to meet statutory services, I think that that's questionable at the moment. Where we are trying to target kind of our focuses on the discretionary services at the moment. But equally, as we all know, many of these discretionary services are absolutely kind of the ones which support the holistic kind of early intervention and prevention. So things are hugely, hugely difficult. And this is probably the most difficult kind of financial settlement that I think we've ever kind of experienced in our time. And I think it's also about where does this mean actually kind of for going forward as well? So I think the financial sustainability is absolutely kind of critical kind of for us.
Okay, thanks for that. Kirsty.
Yeah, just come in on, we kind of focused a wee bit on revenue there, but in terms of capital as well, there is a cut to capital too, and that is putting significant pressures. The capital's been fairly static for the last few years. That's been really challenging to kind of meet all our... sustain our assets, and now it has been cut and there is challenges with RAC, as you'll be familiar with. It's different across the country, but we are facing RAC. We've got costs in Argyll and Bute as a result of a weather incident we had in October that are going to create significant pressure, and there's some of us now looking at LEAP, and we really have to consider whether LEAP is now affordable in line with the revenue and but the capital settlement is putting real challenges on the infrastructure in our communities.
Thanks very much for bringing that perspective in, Jamie. Oh, sorry, you don't... Yeah, actually, no, you don't okay. need to. We will take care of the microphones
for you. Oh,
that's
right, thank you. Sorry, right. Apologies for that. I think probably without wanting to kind of paraphrase anything which my colleagues have said, and I absolutely agree with everything that has been said by the Directors of Finance, I think there continues to be a significant element of financial risk around all of this. I think there's a lot of uncertainty within the system still. There's a lot of checking processes that need to happen. As Martin said, this settlement was given to us, the detail was given to us immediately before the Christmas break, and we continue to kind of work through that detail with a view to setting budgets in February, which is a significant amount of work and a very short period of time to kind of cover that. So there's a huge amount of financial risk within that system, and there's a huge amount of... areas still to be fully quantified, which leads to a level of risk as well.
Thanks. Willie Coffey, you wanted to come in on a supplementary.
Thanks very much, Karina. Good morning to the panel. Martin, your opening remarks there about the 5% real terms increase, where you said it's not that, it's actually a reduction. I wonder, would you have figures that you could provide to the committee to support that? Because the spice briefing we have for today's meeting, which is independent of government, as you know, clearly shows a 5% increase in real terms, and it goes on to say this is one of the largest year-on-year increases to the local government settlement seen over the past decade. So there's quite a difference there in between what you've said and what the independent briefing is telling us. So could you provide the committee with something that would allow us to explore a little bit more about what you've said there?
Certainly, yes. So what that the space figures are comparing our budget at this time last year to the budget at this time this year. They've not taken account of in-year commitments where funding's been provided, principally around pay both for teachers and for non-teaching staff. But there's also an adjustment. So 2 years ago, as part of the pay award, there was capital provided that we could convert to revenue to fund pay. That's now been converted back. So that's part of the reason why there's such a big reduction in capital.
From memory, that was
120
million. So that's all been added onto the revenue. So if to give a comparison, it's as if I was working in a job for 20 hours a week, and let's say I was earning £20,000, and I changed my hours to work 40 hours a week and was paid £40,000, and then got a 5% pay increase, so I'd have £42,000. It's like saying, well, you've had 110% pay increase, because last year you only got £20,000 and this year you've got £42,000. You're not really comparing like for like. You're comparing additional commitments that Scottish Government have agreed to and have been part of that process. But it's not giving us any additional money to deal with inflationary pressures. It's not giving us any additional money to deal with the quite significant demand pressures that Sarah touched on. So there's a whole series of additional funding that's not being included. Mm-hmm. So it's a reduction. I haven't got the figures with me to actually do an analysis of that, but we can get that provided.
That's useful. Thank you.
Yeah, I think when we were at this committee probably this time last year and we were talking about the New Deal, one of the things we'd hoped for that would be one version of the truth. And so it's disappointing that we're seeing that 5% increase. And certainly my members, I was briefing my leader yesterday in our budget position, and he said that the members are thinking it's a good settlement because they've been reading that in the press. Mm. But for us, it's not a good settlement, and it's just a pity that there is different versions of what's the reality.
Mm. Okay. And I kind of along with that, so in COS's response to the budget, it was stated that the budget, as it stands, leave not a single penny for transformational public service reform. And I'd be interested to hear, I mean, obviously you've painted quite a tight picture of it and a very difficult situation. And we also have this agenda around transformation. And I wonder if you see any scope for that in this context. Anyone want to take that?
I think with the current budget figures, we've been trying to reform, and we have been reforming for a number of years, and it's something we'll continue to do, chip away at it as and when we can do it. But I think the financial settlement that we've got makes it really challenging to do that. Martin's already mentioned the directed spend over social care and teachers. So it leaves you very limited areas where you can make savings, and therefore it's limited areas of where you can put in that preventative expenditure, because you've just not got the money. You've not got the same money to do it, and certainly not in the capital side either.
Mm. Okay, thanks. Anybody else?
I think we understand that there's pressures across the system, but it feels as if we're investing in solving the downstream problems rather than upstream prevention. Mm. And that's challenging, and we understand that that's really difficult. It does feel as if there needs to be a very honest conversation about public services more generally and how we work that all together. But at the moment, it feels as if local government's kind of got a little bit of the rough end of the stick and is being squeezed with resources, but having more problems falling their way with the demand pressures that are sometimes coming because of failures elsewhere.
Okay. Jamie.
Just to reinforce that, I think from an Eastern Bartonshire point of view, we have an established hierarchy through which we kind of move to look at transformation, ending with services cessation and service cuts, and those really are the tail end of the options that we would look to exercise. And I think historically we have worked through, you know, service transformations, redesign, co-design, all these different options to try and reduce the financial envelope through which the council works. I think As the Director of Finance have said, the scale and scope of the challenges and the speed at which we need to make those service to reduce the financial envelope now is such that it becomes more challenging, and there is an imperative to move to those more challenging cuts rather than the work that we have been doing historically, which the opportunity is much reduced.
Okay, great. I'm going to move on and bring in Pam Gosol, who's got a couple of questions.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning and Happy New Year, everybody. I have been speaking to councils right across Scotland, and I've spoke to all four of your councillors as well. And the general sentiment around the Verity House agreement is that it's definitely needed, something like that. While all the councils do welcome it, the agreement being there, but not one of the councils believe that it has been working. And one of the councils actually said that, you know, I can't think of a single initiative in which the principles of the Verity House agreement has been applied. So can any of the panel point out an example where you think that the Verity House agreement has applied, and if so, how this might be replicated in future practices?
A very hard question. I think the last time I appeared at this committee, there was a question, and we're probably slightly earlier in the process of the Verity House agreement. And I think, from memory, I said that, as you've said, that it's an important thing. It's important that we get that relationship between local government and Scottish Government right, but the actions would speak louder than words. And at that stage, we hadn't really seen a great deal of actions to support that. I think it would be fair to say that the position is probably marginally better than that, but we still haven't really seen the action. So there's been some early discussions around things. So there's been some early discussions around the fiscal framework, but they've not come to fruition yet. So I think there is some early positive signs, but again, it's actions that will matter.
Yeah, just to supplement what Martin has indicated. Obviously, I think we're all signed up to the principles of the Verity House Agreement and what it's hoping to try and do. I think we are definitely at the start of a journey rather than actually all the way kind of through that journey. A good example of that is obviously there has been some elements of kind of funding which has been baselined within the local government finance settlement. I think that is always kind of welcomed. However, it's not just baselining. Unless you start kind of looking at, Martin and some of my colleagues have already indicated, the level of directed spend, we've probably got about 3/4 of our overall budget which is wrapped up within directed spend. If you reduce kind of ring fencing, that is just one part, but if you've still got all of the policy commitments to still kind of deal with, that's not giving you kind of any flexibility. So I think we're very much at the start of kind of a journey rather than actually kind of all the way through. But I think the principles of the Verity House Agreement and what it is kind of there, absolutely, it is definitely kind of something which certainly kind of for me, I would kind of hold on to. It's now about how we actually try and move that forward.
I suppose I concur with them comments. I suppose for me it's disappointing what has happened in the last 6 months since the Verity House Agreement was signed. But we remain hopeful, as Sarah has kind of indicated, because the principles are sound. It's just we're not seeing the action from that. So I'm struggling to think of the positives, the good examples of it just now, because just now, yeah, I mean, there's been a bit of press about the unring fencing of some monies in the settlement, and there has been some monies, no longer specific grant, but we have been clearly told that we must continue to spend them on the same purpose. So they're kind of, they're not really unring fenced. So we really need to see much more flexibility along that sort of line.
Jamie, did you want to say anything?
I think it's really just to concur with that which my colleagues have stated there. I think there's a really strong willingness to engage, and I think we've seen that through some of the work within the Directors of Finance to discuss these issues and to continue to raise these issues. I think the principles of ring fencing, opening up discretion to kind of councils, will serve local residents well. I think it's just seeing through those commitments and making sure that there's an outcome at the end of it which is positive for all, and I think that's something that we're keen to kind of work through too, but I think the evidence is yet to show.
Thank you. Shall I ask my second question?
Yep.
Thank you, Convener. One of the areas, obviously, that were highlighted when speaking to local authorities was declining school roles, but still face penalties if they attempt to make savings on teacher numbers. So asking you, what impact does the requirement have on the physical flexibility within your local authority on that, but also on the flip side of it, because I know that East Lothian have got different challenges, whereas Argyll and Bute will have a different challenge. You've got more challenges with East Lothian, with obviously growth happening there. So what does that mean to yourself, and what does it mean basically to the flexibility that the areas of funds are ring-fenced, and how does that allow you to innovate rather than just looking at teacher numbers but not looking at the innovation side? So I think both sides, declining and obviously growth.
So Glasgow still has growing school numbers. The profile's changing, so our secondary population is growing quite significantly. Primary is much more of a flat line, but actually we have, I think on average, almost 400 children joining our school system every month, quite often where English isn't their first language, and that brings challenges. I think the teacher numbers challenge is, it's an input measure, and we should be focusing on what we deliver, and teachers isn't necessarily the right answer. I'm sure you've spoken in the past to our colleagues from ADES and education professionals who could provide the kind of technical reasons for that. But education is not just about teaching, it's about a much broader thing. And what this is happening is this is restricting this. It's also, you know, we're measuring a census day. There's all sorts of other factors that come into play on census day. You know, it's who's off sick that day, how that impacts on things. How many people have you got on maternity leave, you know, or on long-term sick, or all sorts of other factors? So, you know, I know our figures are significantly higher than the census figures were. We seem to have had a blip this year with our census data. But the reality is, it's the resources to maintain those teacher numbers. So all of the resources that have been talked about, whether that's for 1140 hours or whether it's the £145 million that was to maintain teacher numbers, those figures haven't changed for a number of years, but the cost of employing a teacher has changed quite substantially over the last 2 years. So we're kind of being held to account for funding that isn't keeping pace with the costs. A number of our teachers are employed through attainment challenge resources, whether that's PEF or whatever. But again, the cost of each of those teachers goes up, but the volume of funding that's there goes down. So, you know, maintaining teacher numbers when the resources to support those teachers isn't increasing means something else has to give. And the pressure of that to give is quite significant. And if it falls on different councils, one or two departments, then the level of cuts. So if we had to take all of our cuts from, for example, from culture and leisure, it would devastate culture and leisure. It would be something like a 55% cut to our leisure budget. Now, that's not sustainable if you're going to have any sort of service in that area. So there needs to be a bit of realism and a bit of honesty as to what's actually achievable and what's the best way to achieve it. But imposing an input-based control isn't sustainable.
Yeah, absolutely. I can 100% concur with what Martin has kind of said here. I mean, certainly kind of for me, obviously, within East Lothian, we have a significant pressure in terms of our growing kind of school roles. We've got 5 new primary schools that we are having to build, and we've got 1 new secondary school. That is huge and significant. I think, though, in terms of your question about how does it impact in terms of innovation, absolutely concur with kind of what Martin has indicated. It doesn't just take a teacher to raise attainment. We've got to look at outcomes in its much more holistic sense, and actually kind of looking at this through a very input kind of and narrow focus kind of lens prevents kind of some of that really innovative kind of approach to what it is that we're doing and how you can try and look at outcomes and local outcomes and kind of aligned with national outcomes in its much more kind of holistic kind of sense. We're forgetting kind of what that does. For us, our education kind of budget is half of our overall kind of budget, and that's not untypical kind of for most kind of local authorities. If you're taking that input approach rather than actually focusing on outcomes, you'll never actually get the desired kind of approach that we're actually actually needing to try and look for. So everything that Martin kind of said there, absolutely kind of 100% kind of concur with this. This is not the way to kind of go about kind of looking at kind of how we support our communities to the best kind of that we can do.
Declining school role in Argyll and Bute. And so the input measure of maintaining the teacher numbers is not helpful at all, because what that means is if you're going to have to keep teachers that you don't have to keep due to the role, you're going to have deeper cuts elsewhere across the council services, and that's not helpful either. I don't work in the education side of the business, but I'm sure it probably does not help with innovation, because in our smaller area, we may have looked at innovating to kind of sharing headships or doing things, kind of video links to ensure that the students get a kind of wide range of curriculum. And you probably don't allow that to happen the same way, because you know that you can't reduce your teacher numbers. So it's not helpful. I think attainment, I understand, has improved, and I think that's what we need to be looking at. And I know at the end of last calendar year, we weren't one of the councils, but the councils that had teacher numbers had gone down, they are in conversations now as whether some money will be clawed back. And that's not a great situation for anyone to be in at the end of a financial year, particularly when we've got a settlement as such we have. And there's still uncertainty of whether we have to maintain the teacher numbers next year. There's no, we haven't had that. I don't think we've had it in writing yet as part of the settlement. We're assuming that is the case, but that's uncertainty for coming forward with proposals to balance the budget as well, as we don't know whether we're going to maintain teacher numbers and if there'll be sanctions like there are in the current year.
Jamie, your area is an area of growth in it, East March.
It is, yes. It's an area of significant demand, and I think significant pressure, and Eastern Bartonshire Council has done an awful lot to manage that demand, but it remains exceptionally challenging. I think we've performed well historically in terms of closing the attainment gap. In addition to that, and we've done a number of things, such as amalgamating our additional support needs schools. And there's a fantastic new school that's been developed to support those in our community. I think probably one of the things that's important to reflect on is that comes at a significant cost. And for us, our early years budget is of the order of £9.8 million, and we commit significantly in excess of that. And like all others around the table, education is one of our most significant budgets. And that additional cost comes at a cost to our core services. So the overspend or the additional commitments within our 1140 will quite likely be highly in excess of the costs for our finance team as a whole. So these are the sorts of decisions that are being taken to commit additional resources across our kind of estate. But obviously that comes at a significant cost elsewhere within the council.
Thank you. Thank you, Camille.
Thanks, Pam. I'd now like to bring in Mark Griffin.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning. I'd just like to probe a bit more kind of the difference between the rhetoric from government about the uplift to local government funding and really the pretty bleak picture that you guys are painting from the coalface, essentially. The Accounts Commission have said that, you know, from 2013-14 to now, that over the course of that 10 years, local government has had a 2.6% real terms increase. But I think, Martin, you pointed out that, you know, when you look at that increase, you can compare that to working 20 hours to go into 40 hours and seeing that increase as an increase in budget. So you could say that mathematically that figure is correct. So I just wonder if you're able to drill down deeper into that and kind of outline in cash terms, but also policy, what those extra 20 hours a week mean. You know, we know about 1140 hours, we know about free school meals, IJB contributions, teacher numbers. Are you able to set out what services you are providing over and above those which you were providing in 2013-14, and what they are costing you, and how you compare that to that 2.6% uplift that the Accounts Commission talk about.
I think that would be challenging to do without having pre warning about that very technical.
I'm more than happy to get question. That in writing if that's easier for members.
I think that would be. It's difficult to do because it's a kind of moving feast all the time, and you have highlighted the significant different areas. So 1140 hours, which I think the total funding for that is now 900 and something million, including the 581 that was baselined this year. But that funding hasn't increased over those years, but the costs have. And in fact, the bit that isn't the 581 million wasn't protected prior to this. But that's a significant additional service, a growth in a service that was brought in. Free school meals, again, is another additional, a significant additional cost. Also in the education, much smaller, but free music tuition and the removal of curricular charges. All of these things have all made a difference to that. But it would be quite a significant piece of work that we would need to go away and to try to come back with a kind of reconciliation of that.
Yep. I think it would be really helpful for us, you know, when we look at budgets year on year and even trying to compare from 13-14 when police and fire were taken out of the budgets to actually know that you're comparing, you know, apples with apples rather than what it seems like we do every year, comparing apples with pears. To give us a real understanding to try and maybe if the committee and parliament are able to provide assistance in cutting through the disparity sometimes in the projection of figures between local and national government, that would be really helpful. So it would be good to get anything you can provide on that. My second question was on a particular area of pressure within local government, and the Local Government Information Unit and their survey had said that the biggest short-term and long-term pressure for budgets was adult social care. I wonder if you're able to set out what is the driver of that pressure, whether it's purely population growth amongst our elderly residents or whether it's a different reason, and what you feel government should be doing in the budget settlement for this year to address that pressure.
So I think probably that, you know, demographics are definitely a significant part of that. Not only do we have a higher number of people in the various elderly age categories, but particularly in the older age categories, but people are also presenting with far more complex care needs than they would have done. People are surviving things they wouldn't have survived in the past with much greater care needs. I think from government, you know, we introduced IGIBs or HSEPs a few years ago, but not a massive number of years ago now. And my personal view is that we've not really allowed them time to bed in and start to make a difference. I think they are starting to make a difference. I think the integration between health and social care is a positive move forward, and actually now trying to change that again without having given time to bed in properly isn't helpful and is actually adding to the workload on a group of staff that are very, very busy to begin with. So I think the proposals around National Care Service have not helped, and actually, you know, removing that that threat would, and that's a personal opinion, it's not an opinion of SITFA necessarily, would help. But yeah, the pressures are well known. I'm sure others have got examples of those.
Yeah, I'm happy to come in and absolutely concur with what Martin has said there. I mean, it's a lot of it is to do with obviously kind of a growing demographic kind of population, but also the fact that people's needs are much more complex than what they ever kind of have before. obviously, I would wholeheartedly concur. I think we all want to improve the outcomes within social care that's there. There are huge pressures that we have got within our social care sector. Certainly within my own authority, they're facing a significant financial pressure next year and across the next 4 years, more than they have ever seen. And that is going to be hugely, hugely difficult for them to be able to try and deliver. I think, though, absolutely, the National Care Service and I suppose the assertion is a real distraction away from what the actual problem is. The problem is that there isn't enough funding to actually go in and support what it is that we're wanting to try and achieve. And I think that often to have that is certainly causing a number of distractions, both locally within all of our staff and across the health and social care partnerships as a whole, where actually the focus needs to be about driving the outcomes and what we can actually do. So, I think it's very difficult. And I think equally, again, it's often a distraction from public sector reform, where the issue is about there isn't enough resources relative to the demands and pressures which are actually in that whole-scale system. And again, just personally from me, there are a lot of things which have been put very positive as part of that integration agenda. I think what we're forgetting, though, sometimes is that, again, it takes a much more holistic approach to improve all of these outcomes. Local government often has, if you don't have good housing, if you don't have good health and that early intervention, it can't just be be met through from the health and social care system. And I think that holistic approach does need to be considered. And sometimes the ring fencing by stealth often prohibits that much more greater emphasis in terms of that integrated outcomes that we're hoping to try and achieve.
Mr. Robertson.
Yeah, I think it's probably worth, I absolutely concur with everything that's been said there. I think probably what we have seen over recent years is a higher level of economic activity as people move through different ages and get older, and I think that's a measure of long-term health and potentially mental health issues as well. And I think local authorities, councils have a significant role to play within education, housing and employment as social determinants of this to help improve as we move forward. So I think we need to be mindful of all those different factors and the roles that local government can apply as part of that whole system approach and investment in health and education to help manage those as we go forward.
Thanks. And I'm now going to bring in Stephanie Callaghan.
Thanks very much, Convener, and thanks for all the information you've given us already, panel. We've already heard about some fundamental disagreements around levels of funding, ring fencing, etc. So I'm wondering how confident you're feeling around agreeing a fiscal framework over the next few months with the Scottish Government and councils. If I could start with yourself, Kirsty.
Yeah, I've not been heavily involved in that. One of our other Director of Finance colleagues takes a lead in the fiscal framework. But the thing we have a focus on is the visitor levy for Argyll and Bute, because that would be something that would be of real benefit to us. But as Martin had said earlier, there seems to be quite slow progress on the fiscal framework work. So I'm not seeing a lot of it at the moment. Hopefully the visitor levy bill will go through. I think it's due to go through in a couple of months. But then we have a long lead-in time for that as well. So, I'm not sure how confident I am in the progress of that.
It's all right. I'm happy for anyone else to come in.
I think more generally about the fiscal framework, rather than the individual tax raising powers, it's getting to the position where we have agreed position as to how local government's funded. It was earlier on, it was referred to the LGIU work, the survey they carried out in Scotland recently. They're carrying out these sort of surveys across the world, and they're working on some information as to where local authorities are more effective in the world. And I think Italy's coming forward as an example, and they're going to produce a report in the near-term future, and it's about the kind of legislative position of services delivered by local authorities and the countries where local government seems to work better or where there's a very clear sort of fiscal role for local government and the services are provided and the funding is provided to deliver those services. So that funding model and how that works within our general system is really interesting, and that's what I would hope we start to take forward and we start to learn from how other systems work and how we can come up with a framework where the funding for local government is much more determined by a formula and determined by need rather than a kind of, if I'm not being rude, kind of horse trading that happens just now.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else? Okay.
Just the only other kind of thing that I would probably kind of add to that, I mean, I've not been quite as heavily engaged kind of with the national kind of fiscal framework agenda as well. Obviously, the focus at the moment is individually for councils to be setting a balanced budget, which is within our kind of legislative requirement. I think anything, obviously, kind of that we can do through the fiscal framework will be really important as part of our future kind of financial kind of sustainability. I think Martin's mentioned the LGIU, and as part of kind of that survey that came through from LGIU, there was a very clear kind of stark warning that the issue of financial sustainability is absolutely much more critical and acute than things have ever kind of been. So the fiscal framework for me is really important in terms of setting that framework kind of going forward as to how we try and deal with it. But we are obviously still trying to deal with the here and now. And I think that financial kind of position and the financial sustainability and the acuteness of kind of that across all kind of the local authorities kind of at the moment is really kind of, it's quite fundamental. And I think it's going to be really important as to how we drive forward kind of that within that context of ensuring that ongoing kind of financial sustainability for the sector going forward, because I think it is hugely difficult and a very key and critical kind of turning point kind of for me. And that was backed up obviously by LGIU as well.
So really critical to have that framework, yep, at this point in time too. So the Verity House Agreement then was looking at multi-year certainty. That was something that was really, really strong in it there. And we don't see that in this budget and financial circular. So I'm wondering, this lack of multi-year funding, what's the impact of that for local authorities and their partners? So how does it impact workforce and how does it impact service delivery? Martin.
Again, I think we've talked about this a number of occasions. You know, it's kind of not logical or common sense to have a one-year settlement for an organisation the size of a local authority and to only be planning 1 year ahead. Now, we're not only planning 1 year ahead. We've all got medium-term financial strategies. We're all looking at that. But I have quite a lot of sympathy, and I should probably stress this is my opinion. I would rather have a one-year settlement with some certainty than, because if Scottish Government's only getting a one-year settlement from UK Government, then to try to do a three-year settlement, there would be quite a lot of guesstimates in that. And if people have lack of certainty, then they tend to be more prudent. So therefore, I think the danger would be we'd get a really bad three-year settlement, and that may lead to behaviour that led to us putting in place deeper cuts than would be required. And, you know, when you make a cut, it's difficult, but we then have to roll back on it. You've still created that level of upset, both for our communities and for our staff. So I understand why we're in one-year settlements, and I'd rather have, I think we need to have certainty rather than speculative multi-year settlements. But it should be coming all the way through the system that we have rolling three-year settlements. So that needs to come from UK government. It is really challenging because we then are an onward provider of funding for, particularly for voluntary and third sector organisations, and without budget certainty, that's really, really challenging. In Glasgow, we made a decision, I think about 18 months ago, to commit to a three-year Glasgow Communities Fund project. So we've provided them with that level of sustainability. But that was an incredibly difficult thing to do. when you don't know what your budget is going to be. But, you know, it's incredibly difficult for the voluntary and third sector to constantly be... You know, the reality is they come to the end of December every year, and if they haven't got guaranteed funding for the following year, they need to give staff notice. And, you know, doing that every year is very difficult to retain good staff when that's the kind of sustainability position they're in. So we really understand how difficult it is throughout, the supply chain. But that we need that to be built into the national system.
Thanks, Martin. Anything to add?
I think Martin has made a lot of the points that I probably would have made as well. I think it's easier for our members to focus on multi-year budgets if there was multi-year settlements. It's hard to get them to not just focus on the year ahead and set that budget. So it would be wholly helpful if we had multi-year settlements. And we did have discussions last year about what level that would be. And if it's too high a level, it's not helpful either, because the devil is always in the detail of the settlement. So it would need to be at a level that would be helpful to councils. And Martin had picked up a point that I was going to pick up about organisations, and we certainly have some organisations that, if we don't give them their funding, know what their funding is until the end of February, that's wholly unhelpful for them. And we've had a couple of organisations have had to issue redundancy notices in advance of knowing their funding. So we are going to kind of look at that in advance and see whether we can commit a year in advance. But we're doing that and we're taking a risk in that because we only have single year settlements. So for me, some certainty would be helpful for our decision makers at our local authority.
So it sounds like there's quite a bit of discussion going forward to be had between local government and national government to sort this out and find a solution that works for everyone. Yeah. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Stephanie. I'm now going to bring in Willie Coffey.
Thanks again, Convener. Two questions from me, one on workforce challenges and one on the council tax freeze announcement. Firstly, in the workforce challenges issue, could you give us a little flavour of how you see that panning out? We know, and we've mentioned already, that there's been a switch from capital to revenue to help support staff pay claims, £121 million, I think. The figure is, and I think that was repeated last year too, but is that the way to do this kind of thing? Are you confident that the local authorities can meet the pay demands that you might anticipate coming forward next year with this kind of mechanism in place, or do we need something else? Start with you, Martin, you mentioned it.
Well, yeah, you know, we're all suffering inflation across the board, and pay inflation is such a significant element of our cost base. You know, workforce is about 60%, 65% of our total spend. So it's a significant cost. Our workforce across the board, you know, work hard. They're not the best paid people in society. We have a significant element of lower paid staff. The driving up of the living wage, which is something we're all very, very supportive of. We want our staff to be paid a wage where they can afford to live. But that brings challenges from a financial point of view and funding that. That needs joint working and Scottish Government, local government to work together on that. I'd say it needs UK Government working with us on that as well, because of the scale of those workforce pressures. Recruiting staff continues to be really challenging. It continues to be really challenging recruiting social care staff, recruiting our lowest paid staff is challenging because the demands, whether you want to work in hospitality, retail or in social care, they now all pay pretty well the same amount. And I think working in social care is quite a hard job for lots of people. So paying at a higher level is important, but actually we have to be able to afford that. Recruiting at the kind of senior and professional level is virtually impossible. I think I told this committee before, which will now be 2 years ago, we just couldn't recruit. We went to the market, we tried to recruit, we got no suitable applicants. So we took on lots and lots of trainees, both graduate trainees and apprentices, to do. And that's for accountancy. Surveyors are the same, lawyers are the same. We can't recruit and we can't retain easily our first-level professionals because the private sector will pay more. So we have recruitment challenges and retention challenges across the board. And it is incredibly difficult. And again, probably needs to go back to that. We need to have a much wider discussion about how we're going to deliver public services going forward, because the financial challenges are at a level where sustainability is a significant issue. In the LGIU survey in Scotland, I think of 43 people that were surveyed, 42 had serious concerns about future financial sustainability of their organisation. And not to be flippant, but I think the other one maybe didn't understand the question. Because I think every single local authority, I think most public bodies in Scotland are in the same position, that that our long-term financial sustainability is at significant risk.
Other views, Sarah, perhaps?
Yeah, happy to just be supplementing just a few things from what Martin has said. Absolutely. I mean, the workforce challenges and recruitment retention are huge across all scale and all sides. I suppose just a couple of kind of things. I mean, you mentioned, is this the right way to, I suppose, support pay negotiations? In my own personal view, no. I mean, obviously, we've just only just secured the local government pay deal for 23-24. That creates significant uncertainty and adds to all of the challenges that Martin has absolutely kind of set out about recruitment, retention. Many of our staff are of the lowest kind of paid. The demands are absolutely huge. And to have that level of uncertainty, you know, during the year it's not appropriate for our highly valued kind of workforce within there. How all of the pay settlements which have came through, I mean, I suppose, remember, they haven't fully funded the pay awards within both teachers and the local government staff. So that's created kind of very significant kind of pressures that have came through there. But the mechanism and the complexities of the funding kind of flexibilities that have done within pay is very difficult, and it diverts attention away from that very real issue of the ongoing financial sustainability, which is where we need to be focusing our attention on. Just the last couple of kind of things for me, we have been innovative, kind of similar to kind of what Martin has said. We've had to, because of all the recruitment issues, we've had to grow our own, and that's been great. It creates kind of innovation, and I think that's been really good. What is difficult, though, is to try and balance that innovation within the funding kind of envelope, because whilst we need trainees to be progressing, you also need people that can support kind of the trainees kind of through all of that. So we've been very good, and we've been having to try and create much more kind of apprenticeship schemes, which is great. It's growing your workforce in a very different kind of way, but equally kind of creates challenges. And I suppose just lastly, kind of from my own perspective, from a relatively kind of small authority, the current pay negotiations are putting a huge amount of pressure, not on just the cost of the public sector, but equally on our pay and grading structures, which are hugely difficult and hugely complicated around it. So there is a lot of lessons to be learned, I would probably say, in terms of how we actually kind of look at that going forward.
Okay, thanks for that, Sarah. Any other views on the workforce issues that we have made? Jamie?
I think it's probably worthwhile saying that for local government as a whole, I think the percentage growth of staff has been fairly static, and that's quite different from what we see elsewhere within the public sector. I think, as colleagues have said, the model is suboptimal. I don't think it provides a level of clarity. And I think in terms of the capital elements, obviously there are ways to kind of manage that. I think my professional view would be that capital funding remains for capital projects and revenue funding remains for the day-to-day running costs of an organisation. But I recognise the pressures that all spheres of government are under. But obviously local government has suffered detrimentally and disproportionately, and that's a view backed up by the statistics in terms of the overall percentage growth within the area, and that sort of masks detailed underlying movements. So there are quite significant variances in, as Martin said, the professional grades as well as those providing essential frontline services.
Thanks, Jamie. Just to clarify something that Jamie said there, because if you look at the figures of local government workforce over the last few years, there's been an increase again, but that increase is as a result of the 1140 hours, free school meals, but also a number of authorities, Glasgow probably being the main one, have transferred a number of what were former ALIOs back into the council family. So in Glasgow, Cordia, which was the best part of, I think, 9,000 staff, transferred back into the council. So that, if you look at those stats, it looks like that, but it's we're not comparing like with like.
Thanks for that. Anything in that workforce issue, Kirsty, or will I move to the council tax? My other question, colleagues, is basically on the council tax freeze announcement that you're well aware of, £144 million, equivalent to a 5% figure. The big question is it enough? And if it's not, what should it be? Kirsty.
I would say it's not enough. I think it's well known that the 144 that's been offered as 5% is not equivalent to 5%. For us in Argyll and Bute, it equates to 4.5%, not 5%. There was a recent LGIU survey, and 83% of councils were looking at a minimum increase of 5%. So that's 83% of councils looking at a minimum increase of 5%. So although 5% has been offered, that is not going to be enough for many, many councils. In Argyll and Bute, you know, our planning assumptions were 5%, but I have to say that was my planning assumptions as a Director of Finance. That was not in discussion with members, and it's members that set the council tax. And one of the things we would always look at once we get our settlement is we would then look at what council tax needs to be. So in light of the settlement that we've now had, I certainly would have been looking as a Director of Finance at, you know, applying a higher percentage than what I had in my planning assumptions based on the settlement. And I think there'll be a number of other councils in that position. What should it be? That's a really difficult question because we're all in a different place. And I think there are a few councils that had gone public. I think it was Orkney, it was at 10%. For me, I think the figure needed to be somewhere up towards about 8% to be realistic. But I appreciate that there isn't the funding there to provide that. And I do question whether the council tax freeze announcement was the right thing to do. If we allowed councils to raise our own council tax, set our rates, and then give us the £144 million, that would be ideal. I think we should push for that. But you know, I know that's not going to happen. I think it was also to protect kind of families and the cost of living. I question, you know, those that can afford it, you're not raising it for these people. So for me, 5% is not enough. It's a discussion that all our councils will currently be having. I'm not sure whether there is scope for that figure to be revisited with Scottish Government, but it's not enough for probably most councils, I would say.
Thanks, Kirsty. Well, we'll just go along the line, Martin, and come to yourself. What
just,
do you think?
Just that, obviously, there's a cut to the core revenue budget of about £62 million, so it takes that 144 down to 80-something, which is 2.8%. But also remember, that's an average. And if you're at the floor, where you're going to lose minus 1.04%, with the multiplier effect on council tax, that's taken away all of that 5%, even without the cut. So for some councils, this will be, we'll take them back to kind of zero, so with no growth from council tax at all. And we haven't worked all the figures through because we're still working on the settlement. But that's on a minus 1.04% floor with a multiplier effect of council tax, that will that 5% will be taken up by that for lots of councils.
Okay. Jamie?
And I think I concur with everything that's been said. I think it's an important statutory lever that obviously council tax is set with reference to affordability and also the residual financial gap. So I think it's a really important local democratic lever that should be exercised with reference to individual circumstances. And I know Kirsty said about cost of living, and councils will have been providing cost of living support to those of most need within our kind of communities, and that will vary to across the piece. So I think for me, I undertook a range of planning assumptions in excess of 5% to provide a level of assurance that we could set a balanced budget, and to a certain extent that option is now not within my hands in totality. So I think that's an important consideration, but also the £144 million, when you look at the shortfall within the budget as well, it doesn't equate to a 5%, and I think sort of brief calculations are something along the lines of 2.8% would be the kind of closer figure, but obviously that's not sufficient for us in terms of setting a balanced budget.
Sarah?
Absolutely concur with all what my colleagues have said there. It's definitely not enough to be able to support, and it's not equivalent to 5% kind of for us. Within East Lothian, we've been pretty kind of vocal to be saying we had a funding gap equivalent to a 32% increase in council tax. Whether or not we would ever have got there politically is a very different kind of story, but that was the scale of our funding gap, and aligned to just what Jamie had said. You should only kind of use, you shouldn't tax in advance of kind of need, and your council tax should really kind of be your closing kind of arena. I suppose just a couple of kind of additional kind of things. We're obviously looking at this as a 1 year kind of position, but there is a bit about this financial sustainability. If we had the ability to set kind of our taxes kind of locally, and possibly most would go well in excess of kind of 5%, that increases kind of your tax base kind of for the next year, and you've got less cuts that needs to kind of be had. So there is something here about your ongoing kind of financial sustainability, and this limits and certainly kind of adds additional kind of pressure and risk in terms of our ongoing kind of horizon. And I think lastly, in terms of kind of the protecting those those families kind of that are on kind of cost of living, everyone is facing obviously continued kind of ongoing kind of financial pressures, but the council tax reduction scheme is kind of there, and it should support most of kind of those that are actually kind of facing kind of the most extreme kind of circumstances. So obviously it's a national choice, as colleagues have kind of said, that as council tax is raised locally, it is for councils in legislation to set the level of council tax, and that flexibility has been taken away from us largely at a time where actually financial sustainability is at such a crucial kind of point.
Okay. Just a final point on it. Do you ever get the opportunity or consider asking your own public what their views are about increases to things like council tax? We could probably guess the answer, but do you ever try to do it? Follow me. I mean, I've been an elected member for a number of years now, and I remember the screaming and shouting about the increases to the council tax year on year. It's a disgrace. Get rid of it. And then the Scottish Government froze it for 9 years. So there's a history on both sides of huge increases, then flat settlements and so on. Where do you see us going with this? Can you give us a glimpse of whether you've asked the public and your own authorities how they see this tax, and should they expect an increase year on year? Would they be happy with that? What's the perception in your own area?
So we certainly do an annual public consultation on our budget process to get a public feel for what they want to do. And actually, the public are very protective of services, and they understand the need to charge more, both from a user charges and from council tax. But I think if you actually just speak to them about council tax, the thing that people understand the least is why are we based on 1991 values? And that just kind of, it doesn't really make any sense to a layperson how council tax works from that point of view. They also have a perception that council tax pays for a much higher percentage of local government services than it does. They're quite shocked when I tell them, so in Glasgow it's only about 14%. It'll be higher in other authorities, maybe up to the kind of high teens. But people are shocked about how little of a council's budget comes from council tax. But the revaluation thing is a much bigger issue from an understanding about how it's calculated and whatnot.
Okay, thanks for that, Martin. Any views on what the public perception of all of this is? Sarah?
Yeah. I'm happy to come in. Yeah, we, similar to others, we go out annually with a consultation, and we've got a majority kind of response back that they would rather see an increase in council tax rather than kind of a cut to services. We kind of equate it to pounds per week because I think it can often, as Martin has said, I think the public can often, you know, be misconstrued in terms of what does this actually kind of mean? What is it? Is it buying? So we certainly kind of set within a range of what does this kind of mean? And there was certainly an overwhelming kind of majority came through in our response that they would rather kind of see council tax kind of rises up to, and when we set it out, it was up to £5 per week, which could equate to round about kind of 10%. They would rather kind of see that rather than a reduction in kind of core services was kind of where the response kind of came through. I would say that's probably not from everyone, but in terms of kind of the responses that came through, there was certainly a majority kind of favour in terms of that.
But you didn't mention the 32% though.
The 32% has definitely been within the public domain. It's been set within our council chamber kind of, and through all of our financial kind of reports and financial kind of planning. So the public are well aware in terms of the challenges within the East Lothian sector.
OK, thanks. Anything on that, Jamie, on the public perception of it?
Yeah, I think, like others, I think it's a standing tenet of good governance, and I think it's a conversation that we've been having with the Accounts Commission in terms of best value as well, to demonstrate that we consult broadly and as broad as possible in terms of not just council tax but all the options. And I think probably one of the things that we and others are more minded to do is not just gather information and evidence, but it's that kind of reflecting back to our local communities in terms of you said, we did. So it's kind of actively closing that circle in terms of good governance. And for us, we would take the statistical analysis of what our residents have said alongside our budget papers, and we have and continue to go so far as to put unabridged comments that the communities have put. But in terms of Martin's reflection, I think our communities are protective and pragmatic about the services that we're delivering, and I think that speaks well to an effective engagement with our communities. I think there's always scope to enhance those, and we've moved from, you know, the sort of the call, click, come in. We're putting these in the digital domain. We're advertising on Facebook and Instagram to get as many people to consult with us as we possibly can, and I think that's given us the good data and good engagement that we need to make sustainable decisions that are consistent with our long-term strategies.
Okay, many thanks for that. Kirsty, anything?
We had gone out and consulted on that last year, and, you know, again, like others, you know, the public generally want to protect the services that we deliver because they value the services, and therefore if there had to be a council tax rise, they were open to that. So I think local government have been put in a really difficult situation this year with that announcement of the council tax freeze. And I think it's going to be really challenging for councils what they're going to do there. If we don't accept a council tax freeze as a council, we're not going to get the money. And I don't know what's then going to happen with that money, how it's going to be used or rediverted. So, but I think it's going to be a really difficult situation because the public will now have the perception that the council tax has to be frozen. And if the local government come along and don't freeze that, that's going to be challenging for constituents, even although they do have that view of protecting their services.
Okay, thanks very much for that, everyone. Back to you.
Thanks, Willie. I'm now going to bring in Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us today. I've got a few questions on different topics. And my first one is with regards to the three shared priorities in Verity House, and specifically around the net zero priority. And given what we've heard, and Kirsty, you've outlined in some detail around cuts to capital budget, just wondered, given that, what impact do you think that will have on realising your net zero commitments? So maybe bring yourself and Kirsty to start and go through the
panel. I think it's really, really challenging to realise some of the net zero commitments because we don't have the funding in place. And there is uncertainty over some funding. And also there's the infrastructure required. You know, take for example electric vehicles. There's maybe not the infrastructure across the country for that sort of thing either. Net zero, I kind of feel linked to climate change as well. You know, we're seeing a lot of we had a significant weather incident in Argyll and Bute in the beginning of October, and we had three bridges that were damaged and a road that was taken out as well. So we're having to do a lot more mitigation measures due to climate change as well. So we're having to use funding for that too. So it's really challenging to it's something we would want to do. We totally agree with the policy of moving in that direction, but it's more expensive to put some of these measures in place. So it's really challenging for us in Argyll and Bute as well. We have a waste PPP contract that runs till after the biodegradable municipal waste ban, and that is going to give us increased costs as well. So It's all coming with the pound signs to deliver on net zero.
It's a very challenging area. Lots of the things that we need to do, and we try to look at as a city rather than as a council, but a lot of things that we need to do, you know, there's not a business case that stacks up. We estimate that the average cost to retrofit every house or every living unit within Glasgow is about £40,000. Mm-hmm. To save somewhere between £500 and £1,000 a year in energy bills. So that's not an investment that really stacks up. You know, save £500 to spend £40,000. So this needs big external money to really make a difference to net zero. What these cuts have done is stopped the council's ability to start to do some of the kind of in-house things. So, you know, decarbonising your fleet is expensive. Mm. An electric bin lorry, it's about double the price of a diesel, and a hydrogen bin lorry, which the technology is not really there for them to work yet, but that's coming in about three times the price of a diesel. So there's real challenges in managing that cost base as we go forward and making those investments. But it does need a much broader view to look at that bigger picture, but certainly our ability internally. Business cases work for some things, but there's a whole host of things where the business case doesn't stack up and it needs public sector funding. Mm-hmm.
Jamie?
Yeah, I think there's a lot of really good work that's going on across all spheres of government to understand the costs that are associated with housing, fleet, embedded carbon. I think there's work that councils are doing in terms of rather than building new buildings and maybe refurbishing them. So there's an incremental kind of process with that kind of general awareness. But I think as Martin says and Kirsty has said, our capital grant from the Scottish Government is of the order of £7 million per year. Our ability to make those to achieve net carbon zero within that financial envelope is significantly curtailed, and there will need to be additional capital resources allocated to enable that to happen. And I think that's part of an ongoing conversation. I'm aware that there's a lot of funding out there. A lot of it's kind of piecemeal, a lot of it's bid-in kind of funding, and I think it's the consolidation of all those individual elements to provide a level of certainty and a level of funding that will enable that to happen in an effective way and in alignment with our kind of joint aspirations.
Yeah.
Just one more kind of thing, kind of from me, absolutely. I mean, I think we've all got that aspiration in terms of kind of net zero. It absolutely has to be there. And I think the public sector does need to kind of lead by example. I think, though, as others have kind of set out, the funding constraints means that that's kind of much more difficult. And I think just the only additional kind of thing which I would say is, obviously there are a number of kind of grant elements of funding. It's not just the capital kind of funding. We've had our regeneration capital grant fund. It's been cut by 27%. So at a time where we're saying net zero is a priority, that doesn't actually kind of back up kind of through a reduction in something which is quite an enabler to try and help and support kind of the move to net zero. So that's just one additional example.
Yeah, that's helpful, and I think links into to my next question with regards to both Argyll and Bute and Glasgow have declared housing emergencies, and as it stands, Fraser Valen Institute suggests about 37% cut over the past 2 years to the housing budget. So just wondered what decision making is taking place around the housing and homelessness emergency and where that will be prioritised, given both councils have declared an emergency around housing.
We are prioritising housing, but we're obviously having to allocate funds for that ourselves, and we're having to look at interventions. The issue within Argyll and Bute is we don't have a lot of house builders wishing to come beyond Helensburgh area to build. It's just too expensive. So in some areas, to build a house on an island, it could be 400,000 to build a house, and that's just not affordable. So, you know, we're then struggling to recruit people because there is just not the housing for them to live in. There's not the housing for locals either. And we also have a number of second homes as well. So that's really the challenge in Argyll and Bute. So we're trying to look and see how we can innovate and, you know, break down some barriers to attract people to come to the area or maybe supplement the cost of housings in order to create more housing. So we haven't fixed the problem yet, but it's something we are working on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Did anyone else want to touch upon that?
I suppose, you know, Glasgow is a very different proposition from Argyll and Bute,
yep.
Geographically, if nothing else. We're not a housing provider, so there's some extra challenges there, but we're working very closely with all of our RSLs and other housing providers, working very hard to try to free up land wherever possible. Also starting to look at, you know, is there other buildings that can be, I suppose, retrofitted in lots of Glasgow areas that used to be housing that became offices. I think there'll be a move back to housing. Mm-hmm. That won't necessarily help directly with the homelessness, but it will have a knock-on effect and a knock-on benefit in that no matter what housing we provide, it will help the situation. But yeah, it's a massive challenge, and it's been exacerbated in Glasgow with the asylum mm-hmm. issue. Yeah.
Just by means of context, from probably a different kind of perspective, obviously, from where Kirsty's sitting from Argyll and Bute. Obviously, East Lothian, I've mentioned before, we are a growing population, significant kind of house building, which is actually going on. We've got acute kind of housing kind of challenges. And at a time where there is such a lot of kind of pressure across kind of the housing sector kind of per se, the reduction in available kind of funding, we're now looking at our capital kind of programme and whether or not we can actually kind of afford to build out kind of the affordable kind of housing in the same kind of way. So that's had a massive kind of impact on a different kind of scale. As I say, and for us, it is important to try and stimulate the economy, to try and get that growth in, to try and provide additional kind of houses. But at the same time, because of all this reduction coming through, we're now having to try and kind of see whether or not we can kind of slow down kind of that. And indeed, kind of looking at all of our kind of programmes, we're trying to be innovative. We've got a mid-market kind of homes model where we're trying to kind of look at it, but this is not easy. And I think that at a time where we need drastically kind of the housing that's there, this reduction is actually acting as a deterrent rather than an enabler to try and help and support what we're supposed to be doing.
Thanks for that. I know since the budget was announced, I've had a number of emails from community groups the third sector who are concerned. And I know in previous meetings and inquiries we've done to look at, you know, the amazing response which they brought to help support the pandemic. So just wondered where the third sector sits within your planning to try to see where those partnerships can be protected as much as possible, and the funding which is handed down to those isn't where councils inevitably start by protecting their own organisation and then taking that money in-house. Martin,
I think I mentioned this earlier. We committed a year and a half ago to a three-year budget, so they've got another year of funding still. So it's not a short-term issue in Glasgow, but it is an ongoing issue as to how you manage that for the very reasons you've said.
Yeah. Does anyone else want to comment on that?
Just coming in kind of from my own perspective, I mean, we work very closely across our community planning partners partnership, including kind of with the third sector. Similar to others, we try and give them as much kind of certainty as we can. I suppose just back to some of the conversations that we've had, though, given the, you know, about three quarters of our budget is directed kind of areas of spend, naturally kind of that places kind of significant pressure on some of these kind of areas of kind of discretionary kind of elements of spend. So it's not easy. We're trying to do kind of what we can. We're trying to kind of work in partnership, but I think it is that whole scale kind of challenge that we've got there.
Yeah, no, that's helpful. Thank you. My only other question was with regard to the impact of RAC, and I know that's something all councils have been working on. That's maybe something you could provide us in written evidence, unless there's anything specific you wanted to put on record today. But otherwise, thanks very much. Thanks, Kavina.
Thanks. We do have a bit of time if anyone wants to talk about RAC and the challenges you're facing. Kirsty, you
Very varied across the country. In Glasgow, we've only got a couple of instances, so it's not a significant issue. But I know for other councils, it's very significant. I don't know if Sarah wants.
We've had a very significant kind of issue on RAC on one of our secondary schools in Preston Lodge High School. Pleased to say we've got a solution that we're actually kind of working through. It's taken significant amount of officer time. It's taken significant additional kind of costs. And we've surveyed all of our public buildings, and we've got RAC. It's not just within our school estate. It's across kind of our other public buildings, and we've been prioritising kind of the school estate. So this is a massive kind of issue which is kind of there. And I think it's, I would suspect, across kind of the public sector and how we deal with it. I think we're needing to kind of look at much more kind of holistic approaches to kind of how we can support this, and I would probably say a much more swifter kind of intervention as to how we can try and kind of support also as well.
Okay, thanks. I'm now going to bring in Marie McNair.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. Happy New Year. Councils across Scotland continue to pay for capital programmes and projects funded by various PPI agreements, and some of them are negotiated kind of a number of decades ago. Can you say how much of this debt your local authorities are saddled with, and whether these schemes have provided good value for money? I'll start with yourself, Martin.
We certainly have quite a significant PPP estate. The majority of our all of our secondary schools and one primary school were refurbished or rebuilt on that basis. The contract has been running for a number of years. In fact, we're now starting to plan for the end of that contract. So we are starting to carry out surveys and whatnot, because the conditions of the contract are that the buildings have to be left with a certain life. So the boilers, the roofs have to be in a certain condition. So we're starting to work on that to make sure that the PFI contractor does the work that they're required to do, so that when the buildings are handed back, they've still got a life. I suppose at the time that it was the only game in town, and that was our only way of funding. So I don't think we've... in the past, we have looked at, was there opportunities to refinance or to reduce costs? And there wasn't. We're now getting towards the end, so we're now really planning for the future. And we will have a school estate that still has a significant life left, and we'll have finished paying off the...
And as the contract ends, obviously, the cost increase as well. Can anyone else share?
their comments on here.
So, just clarify that when the contract ends.
Obviously, you know, the PPI, like obviously the costs, you know, paying it back increased as you kind of got to the end of the contract each year.
So the, we're getting into quite a technical area. So the legislation at the time said that we had to write off the contract over the length, write off the building costs over the length of the contract. There was a service concession 2 years ago that allowed us to alter that to write it off over the length of the life of the building. So that created quite a significant benefit to local government finances. Scottish Government have closed that again. I don't really understand why, because it's good accounting practice to write assets off over their useful life and not over a notional contract. But we're still paying, so from a cash point of view, we'll be in a better position when we finish the contracts, but we'll still be like depreciating them over a longer period of time.
That's something we can take back, though, to the Minister. Yep. Anyone else want to comment about the PPI?
No, I mean, I'm just concur kind of with what Martin has said. We're planning towards kind of now we've got all of our school, our secondary school estate, largely kind of was through PPP contracts. I think similar to Martin, it was the only game in town at that point in time, and we significantly needed to be investing in our school estate. If we had to take that decision now, would we still go down that? I'm not sure kind of that we probably would, but I think it was appropriate at that point in time. And I think now we are kind of planning towards kind of the end of the contract. Naturally, every year we get the same questions from elected members as well, because obviously we are locked in currently as part of the contract at a time where there's high inflation. Obviously, kind of that often kind of raises questions, but it is about looking at kind of that much more kind of holistic kind of sense. And I think certainly kind of for us, it is about planning now towards how can we try and manage kind of our school estate going forward towards kind of the end of the contract. So nothing much more kind of to add to what Martin has indicated.
Thanks for that. And obviously just an issue of council tax fees, obviously touched on it a bit already, but have you made any kind of assessment of how many people have been managing to pay their council tax during the cost of living crisis, and you know how arrears have been impacted, and have you considered like how the freeze will actually prevent some families getting into arrears again?
Certainly, from our point of view, we've continued to work with all residents and encouraged to pay through a variety of different mechanisms to ensure collection throughout the cost of living crisis. We did see during COVID a slight dip in our overall collection levels, but it was of the order of 0.5%, and we held collection through sheriff offices in abeyance for a period of time to allow residents to continue to pay and make payment arrangements and to support them through those kind of sustained arrangements. So I think, and I know there's different views on council tax collection in terms of, you know, where your demographic may be. You know, we've continued to sustain high levels of collection because a lot of our payments are through direct debits, which gives us a level of overall certainty in terms of collections, and that varies across the piece, I would say. But certainly from our perspective, we've continued to support and to ensure collection to safeguard the public purse.
Thank you.
Again, apart from the sort of first year of COVID where we had a slight dip in collection rates have been pretty consistent. In fact, we're ahead of target for this year.
Similar to kind of us, we've managed to kind of sustain relatively kind of high levels of council tax. We've tried to kind of supplement a financial inclusion service. So a lot of the time we're, as Jamie indicated, we're also kind of trying to really kind of support people in being able to pay, being able to maximise kind of their benefits and kind of signposting them. So we've not kind of seen a significant reduction. In fact, it's been an area that, you know, we've managed to kind of largely kind of sustain during kind of the course of the pandemic.
That's really interesting, given, you know, everyone's struggling. It doesn't really matter your income now, do you mean, obviously, with the cost of living crisis that we're facing?
Yeah.
Yeah. I've got time for a very brief supplementary from Willie Cotfield.
Thanks again, Convener. It's just back to the capital allocations issue, if I may. I've got another spice table here in front of me, and I'm scared to ask Martin this question, so I'm going to ask Sarah instead. Because it shows East Lothian's capital allocation, Sarah, going up from £7 million last year to £25 million. That's a standout change in the table that we have here. Most of the authorities are showing a reduction. It was just to ask if you know why that is. Is it, we think it might be flooding allocation, the extra fund, finances for flooding. But even if you take that into account, East Lothian's capital allocation is actually going up.
I'd need to come back to you kind of specifically in relation to our capital allocation. Our general capital grant this year has reduced from last year by about £250,000. We have got, we are part of, as part of the flood prevention scheme, we've got two schemes ongoing. We've got significant funding for Musselburgh Flood Prevention Scheme, which is going through dual process, and also for Haddington Flood Prevention Scheme, which has seen very significant increases, but as part of the our overall general capital grant, we're seeing a reduction of about £250,000. So I'm more than happy to come back to you kind of specifically in relation to the spice question, and certainly it's an area that we'll be looking, but that's not aligned through to kind of our intelligence as to kind of what we're kind of seeing through the information, but more than happy to kind of provide some supplementary information through to you.
Okay, many thanks for that. Thank you.
Okay. Great, thanks for that. So, thank you very much for giving your perspectives on the picture of the budget for local government, the settlement today. And as we previously agreed to take the next item in private, and that was the last public item on our agenda today, I now close the public part of the meeting. Thank you. Thanks.